All right, would someone please certify the closed meeting? Yes.
Madam Chair, whereas the Falls Church City School Board has convened a closed meeting on the stage pursuant to an affirmative recorded vote in accordance with the provisions of the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, thank you. And whereas Section 2.23711B of the Code of Virginia requires a certification by the school board that such closed meeting was conducted in conformity with Virginia law, now therefore be it resolved that the Falls Church City School Board hereby certifies that to the best of each member's knowledge. One, only public business matters lawfully exempted from open meeting requirements by Virginia law were discussed in the closed meeting to which the certification applies. And two, only such public business matters as were identified in the motion convening the closed meeting were heard, discussed, or considered.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. Second?
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Litton.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Castillo?
Aye.
Ms. Litton?
Aye.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
Ms. Russell?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Oh, you skipped me.
Thank you.
Aye. It's okay. Yeah.
I'm so sorry.
It's okay. Aye. Ms. Scott. No worries. All right. Thank you very much. Okay. We'll move on to the section four of the agenda, our spotlight on Team FCCPS and our highlights from Jesse Thackeray, Matt Daniel, and TJ.
Madam Chairman, I make a request that we take a very short break. Can I get started?
We will take a very short break.
Thank
and
you.
Be right back. Okay, we will now reconvene though. So we'll go on to our spotlight, and we've got our principals here now. And I'll turn it over to Dr. Noonan.
Thank you, Chair Gill. Good evening, everybody, and welcome to those of you that joined us post-closed meeting. Tonight, we have an opportunity to hear from from three of our school leaders, Rachel Hamburger at Jesse Thackeray Preschool, Paul Swanson at Thomas Jefferson, and Tim Kasich at Mount Daniel. And I'd invite the three of you up to the table if you'd like to join us. They're here in case you have questions. And so tonight, we're doing something a little bit differently than we've done than we did last year. I was going to say that we've done in the past, but it's a recent past. This time last year, we had the three principals come one evening, and then the two secondary principals come one evening and do a state of the schools address to the school board. And this year, because of timing and just the number of things that are happening in the division with the high school and the new addition at Mount Daniel, and just so many things that have been sort of pushing on us time-wise, we decided that we would try a new approach this year to see how it goes. So tonight we're going to share with you a brief video that these three fine leaders are in and are sharing about their schools. And then if you have any questions, we certainly would open it up then to any questions that you might have. So with that, I'm going to let John start the video.
So we had three objectives on our school action plan this year. The first was that during the school year, teachers would collaborate in teams of 2 to 5 twice a month to plan instruction and review data. We talked a lot about differentiation throughout the year and how we would meet students where they were and either go up and challenge them or bring the content down a little bit to really support children where they were and help them build those skills to meet their peers. In addition, we had a monthly planning meeting, and the team focused on what students know, what they want them to learn, and what they were going to do if students didn't learn what was being taught. We were very fortunate this year to be able to collaborate with Dr. Jen Santiago, who's the LEAP coordinator, and she helped us to realize that what teachers are doing in their classrooms by providing a language-rich environment and making sure that there's lots of opportunity to use and practice English language really is best practices for young students. We were able to collaborate really nicely with Julie Macrina, who's the Multi-Tiered Systems of Support, or MTSS, coordinator for the school division. And she helped us, along with Dr. Jason Cheka, who's the school psychologist, to develop a plan for MTSS. So for Tier 1, when we just have a concern about a student, we had a kid talk and a discussion about where they were and what those concerns were. And we were able to work in our collaborative teams and really discuss where students were and what we could do to help them. We also developed a process if we need to go to tier two or tier three, which is more intensive interventions, and we developed that process and how we would use it moving forward. This past year, we've really enjoyed collaborating with teachers from around the division. So Jamie Sample is our music teacher this year, and she's also the high school choir director. And she was able to bring over some of her students to sing with our little guys in December, which everyone enjoyed all around. We've also had Joe Musket come over and do PE, so that has given us more of a connection to Mount Daniel. So really building those strong foundations to be a pre-K 12 school division has been really nice. As we move forward, I'm really sad to leave JTP and FCCPS, but I know we've got lots of systems in place for a fabulous school year next year, and I look forward to hearing about how things go.
As I begin to wrap up my first year as a principal in Falls Church, I can say that it's been a very exciting year. We've already undergone many changes. Our facility is beautiful, and we've been able to maximize the space to provide world-class educational opportunities for our students. And looking forward, we're so excited to welcome the second grade team and to be able to keep our current first graders as the first cohort of second grade students at Mount Daniel. One of our objectives this year was to provide equitable core instruction, resources, and training for both students and staff. Teachers have designated collaboration time to learn with each other to ensure core instruction is happening at a very high level. Additionally, professional development opportunities are available to all teachers and staff. We're looking to have two collaborative team meetings per week where teachers can learn together, analyze student data, and focus on student achievement. PYP is embedded in our daily instruction. For example, our kindergarten team has been learning about Mexico and the geography of Mexico. In science, our children are learning about volcanoes. So what the kindergarten team has done is talked about the geography of Mexico and where volcanoes might be located in Mexico. Another objective for the year was to establish at least two co-teaching models for special education and a more deliberate push-in model for our LEAP students by the end of 2020. Special education teachers and general education teachers have had professional development focused on co-teaching. We have one co-teaching model in kindergarten and one co-teaching model in first grade. Additionally, the teachers work together to plan instruction that's designed to meet the needs of all the students that they serve, whether it's in a general education setting or in a special education setting. Our LEAP teachers have been visiting schools in surrounding jurisdictions, learning various ways to successfully implement a push-in model in which co-teaching will support the needs of our English language learners. So our third objective was to design structures and opportunities to collaborate within grade level teams and departments, as well as school-wide or cross curriculums, and we want those structures to be in place by the 2019 school year. As we prepare for the 2019 school year, we're collectively writing a school vision and mission that reflects our core values and beliefs around instruction and student achievement. We are planning our master schedule to reflect these values so that we can maximize our instructional time to meet the needs of our students. These changes are exciting for the entire division. We're hopeful to continue our vertical articulation with Thomas Jefferson and to align some of our structures and practices to continue to meet the needs of our students as we look at a K to 5 continuum.
We thought, I think in broad terms, about who are the kids that could most benefit from our extra help, and then we also thought systematically about what are the programs that can umbrella over all kids and what are those programs that we could choose to focus on. And so one of the goals asked us to be at or above the state average in math for our ESOL students. Jennifer Fessenden has taken on even more of a leadership role in helping us to evolve the use of number talks. So many of our math lessons begin with number talks. That's been very helpful for a lot of our kids to just develop conceptual understandings. We have also introduced a before school math club here, and we don't necessarily think of that as a band-aid, but we do think of it as something that's been helpful for the roughly 40 to 50 kids that are coming. We have have had a training session on the use of anchor charts. So the idea is particularly for our LEAP kids to make math classrooms even more visually accessible so that kids are not only hearing this lesson, but they're seeing in a visual sense reminders about here's what this concept means, here's the definition of this mathematical term. We have, with the leadership of Jennifer Santiago, begun a LEAP cohort here. So we have monthly meetings of our teachers that will get together and talk about some facet of LEAP and ESOL instruction. We, like all Falls Church schools, are really committed to the IB program. It's something we care about. We desperately want to be outstanding at it. And one of the revelations for us at the beginning of this year is that when we did a survey of our staff to gauge their comfort level, there was a pretty wide swath of staff members that indicated that they didn't have full comfort with implementing the elements of the PYP in their classrooms on a daily basis. One of the things that we did was that Carrie Checa, our K-5 PYP coordinator, along with our fifth grade team, did a professional development session on provocations. Provocation essentially is a way to begin a lesson in a creative, engaging way that gets kids wondering, where's this lesson going? Why are we doing this? Previously, we had a PYP meeting for each grade level once a month. We've doubled that. We're now meeting twice a month. And during those meetings, we've got teams that are talking about planners. They're talking about summative evaluations, all the components of the IB experience. This summer, we have around 13 staff members that are going to an international baccalaureate official training, and we're looking to send those folks to different workshops and things like that. We've had third and fifth grade really working hard on performance-based assessments, and one of the neat things about those grade levels is that they have begun to do what we call a crosswalk. In other words, we're looking at individual IB themes like how we organize ourselves, where are we in time and place. And we're looking not only at the central idea and what themes are we covering, but then we're also marrying that with Virginia State standards to figure out what standards are we teaching in each one of these units. So it's been helpful to be able to marry the IB program with SOLs, but it's also been helpful to make sure that we, in fact, are teaching all the standards that we need to. We view this as a transition this year, a transition into a season of mighty change. We are seeing an entire grade level go to a different school. We're having staff that's being transferred to meet needs across the district. So it's going to be a new school next year. So I think that we envision, while we continue to work on school planning documents and school planning goals, I think that we envision a chance to really hit a reset on what is already a very good program here and to think about how can the new Thomas Jefferson with three grade levels instead of four, how can we raise our level of excellence even higher?
So I'm going to sort of kick this off and just say, first of all, thanks to our three school leaders for being here tonight and for participating this way. Again, kind of going back last year, they spent about an hour of time doing their presentation, and we just thought that this perhaps was a little bit more efficient. My hope is that in that video that you observed this evening, there were a couple of things that you heard, and I guess I could have scaffolded it for you and said, here's what I hope that you'll look for. But some of the things that I hope you heard was each of them have developed school plans, and those school plans have very specific goals that they worked with their staff on to develop that are aligned to our triennial plan and aligned to the work of the placemat that we've put together. So one piece that I continue to support and sort of carp on a little bit with our leaders is that there has to be this really strong alignment from pre-K through 12 all the way up through leadership at the central office to the school board and then back down. So the decisions that you'll make tonight, for example, around the budget, are rooted in our triennial plan. And so the work that they're doing at their schools are rooted in the triennial plan. So hopefully you heard some of that in the video. And my other hope is that last year at this time, you adopted a budget that included some positions and some realignments of some positions that were really important to us here in the system to really provide some extra support for our schools. So you heard names like Jen Santiago, Julie Macrina. We have Seamus with us this evening. Those were three people that are new to our system, and those positions were new last year as a result of some decisions that you made, and they instantly have had an impact in the schools working with our folks. In addition to those three, Jen Fessenden and her work in mathematics has also been really powerful. So really that focus has been important. And the last piece that I hope you heard in there was this idea of, you know, when we talk about all kids, we really mean all kids. And our work really needs to drill down to be able to differentiate to meet the needs of every single student we have. And so by creating a new set of skills for many of our teachers and working with them on how to differentiate, how to work through a different math program, how to do the reading intensive care unit program and do some other things in our schools. We're really trying to crack the nut of intervention so that all of our kids are successful. And none of that would be possible without the leadership of the three people that are sitting here tonight. So I do want to say thank you for your work and then offer them up for questions, throw them to you. So with that, I'll turn it back over, Madam Chair.
Any questions or comments from the board? Mr. Reitinger?
So I'll start. Again, thank you all for being here and for doing the video. It's really great to hear from, as Dr. Noonan says, the school leaders personally about what their experiences are. This is more sort of a summative question, not a summative assessment, but so it's a little odd to lead with it, but since I'm talking, I'd be very interested to know if any of you have specific requests for the school board or things that you think we need to pay special attention to, requests for us to put on our agenda, or, you know, I don't want to ask you to, you know, undercut the budget requests we've already put forward, but if there are things that you think could help your schools in particular that the board ought to pay a deeper amount of attention to, this is a great opportunity to tell us about it.
It's a good question. I wish that I had a meaty answer, but I really don't, and I'm probably going to sound like a politician, but I think to a principal in this district, I think you would hear from every one of us, both publicly and privately, that we genuinely feel supported by this board, genuinely feel supported by our central office. Dr. Noonan is absolutely right. You know, this division came to this board and this community last year asking for the very things that I think you're talking about. And this board listened, and you delivered as much as you responsibly could. And I hope that there's some benefits that are pretty obvious from that. So the answer to your question is, I can't think of any gaps.
And I would echo those sentiments. I think that there were some significant additions last year. I want to include Carrie Checa to that list because she is our PYP coordinator at Mount Daniel and Thomas Jefferson. And she's really helped our teachers kind of plan around these units and really make it come alive for the students. I feel as though the current budget as it's been presented really does reflect the needs right now of our school division, and would like to thank you for the continued support that you're continually giving to the schools, because we are fortunate to live in a community that is full of supportive individuals like yourselves who, you know, will continue to give and give, and not just give but continue to ask, what more do you need? So we appreciate that.
Agree with what Paul and Tim said. It's great to be supported. I was talking to someone today about working in Falls Church City, and it's really amazing to have all the supports of the school board and work closely with central office and have that full support behind us as we run our schools and work closely together. So thank you.
Ms. Lynn?
I'm just curious to get your sense of how you think teachers in the district are feeling. You know, I think in general there are a lot of demands on teachers these days. You know, do you think they feel like they have enough energy to get through the end of the year, or do you feel like people are pretty burnt out?
So I kind of consider part of my job to be the cheerleader for the teachers. And certainly this week with Staff Appreciation Week, it couldn't come at a better time. And the community has really rallied to make sure that our teachers feel loved and supported. Teaching is a very demanding job, physically and emotionally. And we do get to this point in the year where things kind of, they just really kind of build up. And we've been working so hard. I know my friends over at Thomas Jefferson and Henderson and Mason, they're getting ready for their end of the year exams, whether it's, you know, SOL, IB, or what have you. Those are big kind of milestones for a lot of our kiddos, and our teachers pour their heart and soul at all grade levels, from JTP all the way through Mason. I would venture to say that while they're tired, they feel supported. Everyone is looking forward to going and recharging this summer. And I think they would say that they've had a great year. And, you know, I can speak for myself over at Mount Daniel. It's been a year of a lot of transition and change. We started off the year with our first graders working in trailers and having no parking lot to moving in the middle of October and, you know, beginning of November, and then to finally getting our parking lot at the end of January. So it's been a kind of whirlwind. So they've been through a lot. They've had a lot on their plates. And that's all in addition to, you know, planning meaningful lessons and analyzing student data and certainly being available to parents at all hours of the day. They've held their heads high, and they've marched through it, and they are looking forward to getting a chance to recharge. So.
There's truth to the text that underlies your question, Ms. Litton. And I think if you were to ask teachers how they're feeling on September the 3rd compared to how they're feeling on May the 7th, there's no question that you're probably going to get some different answers. But I agree absolutely with what Tim has said. And I also think that even you asking that question is evidence of the support that this board is willing to lend to teachers. I think that your question is linked to the first one that was asked here. It's a very busy time for teachers. They're carrying a lot. And I think the fact that they probably do feel really tired is tangible evidence of just how dedicated and how much they care. But thanks for asking.
Anything else? Mr. Anderson.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So in the video, I was struck, there's three things I want to pull together, one from each of you guys, into a question that I want to ask. And you were talking about ties across the schools and having Jamie Sample come down and Muska come down and do PE. And then there was conversations about mission and vision and the excitement of second grade staying and being able to have that cohort. And then the season of mighty change, I think, was the phrase. I like that, by the way. And the comfort level that you have with IB. But one of the things you all talked about was the planning and how to develop your mission and vision for your school. And what I'm curious about is you each also talked about the pipeline between schools. How do you actually build? And I'm curious how you actually do this. How do you actually build your plans at your school to tie them to each other, and then working with your team, working with your staff, working with the teachers? I'm just kind of curious about how that works.
I'm going to answer this question, or start off my answer the way my colleague, Mr. Swanson. That's a really good question. Thank you for asking that. It's a really complex question because it's very complex work. One of the opportunities that's been unique to us this year, I think, is just with the transition of second grade to Mount Daniel, we've been forced to take a really close look at the way that we operate. For example, how many minutes of encore classes each day do children receive? How often teachers get planning time, and just all those little details that go into what a master schedule would look like, forced us to kind of come to the table together with a team of teachers from both Mount Daniel and Thomas Jefferson to kind of grapple with and answer some of these questions and to make some decisions about how we operate, you know, across schools. Having the opportunity to share certain staff members next year, I think is going to strengthen some of those vertical pieces that we have. I know that with Mr. Musket going to JTP a couple of times a week to provide physical education for our preschoolers, he's been able to kind of lay that foundation and to help help our youngest learners know what it means to be in a gym class, so that when they do come to us when they're in kindergarten, they're prepared, and he's already built those relationships. I would say that relationships matter, and when we think of, you know, strengthening those bonds between the three schools, just the unique opportunity of having certain staff, like I said before, that will be serving both schools in different capacities, will just kind of help strengthen the unification between the schools.
I also think there's some there's some decisions that can be made at the leadership level to support that with respect to how we utilize some of our professional development days and how we organize those professional development days. And I think what I've heard through some listening tours that Ms. High has done, hearing from the principals, one of the themes that's come out is that our teachers really would like more time to plan with their colleagues vertically as much as they'd like some time horizontally. So one of the pieces that we will look at as part of our professional development planning for next year will be looking at being really strategic and thoughtful about how we can coordinate those times when we have half day Wednesdays or we have other PD days during the year to develop structures that allow for that to happen. Because I do think it's really important, particularly around as I think next year we're going to really double down hard on the IB piece too, and being able to talk about the work that's happening in their unit planning in first grade and how the unit plans are coming together in seventh grade and the unit plans are coming together in 12th grade, because then you can always work backwards and forwards to see how that how those linkages are made.
Any other? Oh, Mr. Swanson?
I was just going to add that some of that connective tissue has happened even before this year. For instance, I think Mrs. High has organized some K-5 trainings around special populations, but I also think that some of that marriage is inherent in some of the documents that have been created in the last 18 months or so in this division, like the placemat and the triennial plan. Each one of our schools, I think, does have some separate needs based on the needs of our kids, but I think those are married when you look at that placemat, that every single one of our planning goals is fixed in that placemat somewhere.
If there's no further comments, I just want to personally say thank you. My children have benefited from all of your leadership. And I especially want to thank you for at Mount Daniel, when you brought up that the first grade was in trailers this year, I actually forgot that even happened. And I have a first grader, because it was so seamless, the transition from trailers to being in the classroom, and not one step was missed. So kudos to the staff and teachers and leadership, especially at Mount Daniel, for really making that. And I'm sure it will happen again for second grade in the fall. And there was not a beat was missed. So thank you so much to all of you. All right, the next item on the agenda is recognitions and reports, and we have none. So we will move on to section 6, public comments and requests. In accordance with school board bylaw 2.30, the time for each speaker is limited to 3 minutes. Additional written statements may be submitted to the clerk for dissemination to board members and for the record. I have two public comments. First is Sign Anderson. Come on up. You can pick either one, whichever one is easier.
So my name is Sonia Anderson. I need to send my address, 423 Hampton Court. And I just wanted to thank the board for sponsoring the amicus brief on the Gavin Grimm case, because I'm a sophomore at Mason, and I'm trans, and so, like, it really means a lot to me to, like, see you supporting space for like students like me. And I was one of the members of the GSA who met with like the building development team about like gender neutral bathrooms and things in the new school. So like, I just really appreciate like what you've done like to support a community like this.
May I ask a question of the speaker?
Just for the good of the people in the audience that might not know, it's unusual for us to ask questions of people that come up, but there's a relationship here.
Unless it's a child.
Unless it's a child of a board member.
On behalf of the board, I would just actually like to say I've been very proud of us as a board in our belief and support in non-discrimination for youth in all of our schools and all of our kinds of youth and all of our students. And I think we've done a really good job, especially with our policies that we've passed in the last year on this one. So thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Anderson. Our next comment is from Melissa Teets.
Melissa Teets, 802 Ridge Place. So a few weeks ago, there was an editorial, I guess, in the news press about if we should put the photos back on the wall of the chamber, and that should we like automatically put all these old photos back up or not. And it actually made me think about, actually I never got around to actually going and reading this editorial, but it did make me think about George Mason as a name for our high school. And I wonder, as this is our opportunity to really look at that name and decide if that's really the name we want for our high school. Truthfully, I never paid attention to George Mason. I remember him being like a footnote in history, and he's not someone like Thomas Jefferson or James Madison that you really know about. I did go look up his history, and I just don't think he's a wild kind of person. He was a Virginia delegate to the Constitution, writing of the Constitution. He chose not to sign the Constitution. He was afraid of the effect on states' rights at the time. He was also afraid on the economic, his economics as a Virginian. So I'm not sure if he's really someone we want representing our school. I've been going around and just asking people how they feel about it, and a lot of people have said to me, you're right, I'd not really looked at his name before, looked at who he was, and he isn't a great person. The other thing, which I thought was really interesting, a lot of people also said they were tired of people confusing us with the university. Actually, my own daughter told me that. She was, she's a counselor for a Girl Scout camp, and she was meeting with some of the adults, and they asked where she went to school, and she said George Mason. They were like, oh, you're so smarter, you're at the university already. She goes, no, I'm at the high school, George Mason. And she just, it was funny, she just told me the other day. But anyway, I think as a community, if there was a time to change the name of the high school, would be while we're building a new high school. Because we're already going to take on those costs of putting new names up, new signage up. There's a lot, it would give us a couple years to transition. I think it would be wrong for us not to have some kind of discussion. I am not militant here. I'm not saying we have to change it. But I think if any of you go home and look up George Mason's history, you're going to find out he is not a founding father, really. He's like a footnote. And all the founding father lists I saw, even one with 20, he never made it in there. So he's not exactly what people think he is, I believe. And that's including me. I went for years not really looking him up. And he, despite the fact that he's all over our city. He's also a Fairfax County resident, But anyway, so I just want to put that out there. And in general, like, I've talked to, about 30 other parents. I've only had two who kind of gave me pushback. One, because they were like, why fool with history? And another, because they were alumni and I don't want to change the name of the high school. And I get that. But I actually just had a lot of people go, I've never looked him up. They looked him up and they were like, you're right. He's not really someone you admire that much. So I just want to put it out there. I don't think we should blindly go forward without discussing this as a community.
Thank you very much. Do we have any other comments this evening? All right, seeing none, we'll move on to our consent agenda, and I would seek unanimous consent to approve the agenda as presented. Yes, okay. We'll move on to Section 8, Business Action Information. Our first is 8.01, Julian Williams.
I'm going to invite Dr. Williams to come on up to the table. We're really excited to have Dr. Williams here tonight to share with you some of the work that he's intending to do with us here in the City of Falls Church. But just let me provide a little bit deeper context than just that. Earlier this year, and even last year, and even prior to that, we have had a number of experiences at all of our schools, even Mount Daniel all the way to the high school, where students have engaged in behavior that is that's inappropriate and hurtful, and often related to race, ethnicity, religion, gender, and the like. And so this year, specifically, we've done a couple of things, and we really wanted to address this work sort of head on and say, one, it's not acceptable behavior for our students, for our staff, for our community to engage in anything that indicates any prejudice, any hate, and the like. And so as a consequence of that, we've done a few things. One is we've set up first an equity team that has a number of people on it. It's co-led right now by our two deans of students, one at the high school, one at the middle school, so Sia Knight and Adam White. And then the principals sit on that team with some other members of staff. And through their work, they supported us in organizing around getting Dr. Joseph Williams up to the City of Falls Church Schools from the University of Virginia to do some training and professional development with our teachers, and also some professional development with our parents and some development with our parents. And that has been very well received, I think, across the board. Our teachers then, along with the principals, have turned around some of this work and spent a lot of time with their students, talking with them about race and about ethnicity and microaggression specifically. So that has been a really nice entree into this work with Dr. Joseph Williams. That alone is not enough. And I think that there has to be another piece to this, and this is where Dr. Julian Williams comes in. Dr. Williams is currently, I'll let you tell what your position is when the time comes. He's at the other George Mason.
Not to be confused with the high school.
Not to be confused with the high school. But he is going to come in, and he is going to work with us to hold some focus groups, some conversations with parents, and he'll kind of talk about that, parents and school board members and staff and some students. He's going to review our curriculum to see, is our curriculum aligned with what our values are as a board? So when we look at things, and I don't want to throw any thing out there that is you know, could potentially be problematic, but I do think that there are some things that we have to look at. And I'll just give an example. I think we need to look at how we celebrate Colonial Day at the elementary school. And is the way that we celebrate Colonial Day, for example, consistent with our beliefs and values with respect to fairness and equity? How do we deal with Columbus Day in the City of Falls Church is another one, or curriculum around Columbus. So he's going to do some of that walk for us, and in the end, hopefully come back and provide us with some ideas and some thoughts about how to move forward. And so with that sort of as a backdrop, I don't want to steal everything you were going to say, but I do want to turn it over to Julian Williams, who's here tonight and has been already a really great strategic partner with us, a really great thought partner with us. And with that, I'll turn it over to you. Thank you.
Thanks so much, Dr. Nguyen. I really appreciate it, and I appreciate the board's time today as well. So in my day job, I am the Vice President for Inclusion and Diversity at George Mason University out in Fairfax, Virginia. And one of the things that I look forward to engaging with FCCPS around is even some of the conversations that you've had already, is sort of how do we institutionalize the work around inclusion and diversity? And the way that I sort of situate it and talk about it is sort of we have our values and who we are as a school division or an institution or whatever that looks like. And then there's what the experience is. And usually our values are very artfully written. They're effusive around who we want to be from an inclusion and diversity standpoint. But we have to really juxtapose those values with what the experiences are like for students or parents engaging with the school division or for faculty members or instructional staff members around feelings of support, feelings of efficacy, feelings around where the gaps may exist. And so I applaud FCCPS around the work that's already been done, because I think that can really be a springboard to what true institutionalization of the work around inclusion and diversity can look like for the school division. I hope to help to sort of identify where some of those gaps may exist between experience and values to deliver the school division an action plan to what I would hope to is to address what those issues are. But my sort of philosophy around this is that any solution, particularly one around inclusion and diversity, has to be sort of homegrown and sort of home driven. So, you know, I may have what my thoughts are around sort of what the key issues are, or what even what the solutions or steps towards solutions may be. But I'm not the one that will have to experience those. I'm not the one that would have to sort of live those experiences. So I think it has to be sort of self-identified, self-defined. When we think about what diversity looks like, obviously we're going to take a very broad lens to that because, as you all know well, the school division is very broad and diverse from a multitude of perspectives. And we're going to, I would hope to take a look at all of those perspectives as well. But to deliver an action plan that is in a lot of ways driven by the community, driven by the constituents of the school division, I look forward to speaking with all of the board members as a kickoff to get your experiences, to have some one-on-one discussions or two-on-one discussions with each of you, and then to start doing some of that work in the school division as well with constituents, whether they be in the community, whether they be students, those instructional staff members that are undertaking a good deal of this work, and then to deliver, as I mentioned, an action plan that will help the school division sort of get there. So my hope is that this is an iterative process, a self-defined process, one that engages as many parts of the community as necessary. So in my even open and sort of initial conversations with Dr. Noonan and his team, the conversations are around is, okay, who as you look at sort of project forward at to the end of this, if I don't talk to this person or these groups, would that, you know, who definitely needs to be at the table? And I want to include all of those constituents into this process because I think it has to be community driven. So you have the sort of timeline and deliverables. We're operating at a pretty aggressive timeline, but I think it's a doable one to have something back to the superintendent and then ideally shared with the rest of the board members sometime late July. Obviously, that, you know, if we have to adjust that, we will. But I really hope to kick off conversations with the board and then work across the school division from there. So I'm at this point open to questions around you know, approach or deliverables or anything that that the board would like to discuss. But I also wanted to thank Dr. Noonan and all of you for the opportunity to engage at this level.
I'm going to add one comment, and I hope it's okay.
Sure, yeah,
Julian has just recently completed his work similar to what he's doing with us in Arlington County. I just spent a couple of days at the Virginia Association of School Superintendents and was talking with Pat Murphy, who's the superintendent in Arlington, about that. And the focus of the conference at VAS was around equity and diversity. And so we were at a table sort of talking about the work that's been going on, and he was effusive, to take your word, about the work that Julian did with Arlington and some of the deliverables that were given to them too. So there's a good model there for school divisions as well.
Questions from the board? Ms. Russell?
So this might be more appropriate to the small group or two-on-two or one-on-ones.
Sure.
But one of the things, I guess, and this is just from a personal standpoint that I struggle with regard to my teenage son, is I feel like there's a big disconnect or gap between trying to navigate the music that they listen to versus what, you know, they can project. And so I guess, you know, he's obviously very much into the rap music and R&B and stuff, which I think is great. And I have to say I've developed an appreciation for it because there's a lot of good, I think, that comes out of it in terms of the interesting social messages and the poetry. But there's also obviously a lot of things that I don't particularly know how to talk to him about or approve of. And so I think that, you know, trying to navigate that as a parent and, you know, trying to help him understand, it's, you know, obviously he knows what's not appropriate to say, or at least I hope he does, but also just the issues that it brings up too. I think that there's, you know, in a sense that that's a kind of disconnect between home or I guess personal life and school. And so what they're doing in their personal time versus, you know, what the school is projecting, because obviously the values of the school are,
Well, I think it's opportunity. It's a time to think about sort of how to bring the two together. So I think about their classes at Harvard on hip hop, like the origins of it, breaking down and studying specific artists and their messages and the social impacts behind it and all of those things. So I say that, and that may not help out, help you out in your your sort of home conversations,
right,
but it's sort of how, you know, an art form may have elements that we can study and may have elements that deserve more conversation as well. So there's a curricular piece to it that even some higher ed institutions have sort of taken on as well. And that may be a good way to maybe approach some of those, you know, conversations as well, is to trying to study impact and defining that from there.
I mean, I guess it's just, you know, it's difficult terms and, you know, the popular culture component of it.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think trying to navigate that piece, because obviously there's a lot of other elements that we're working with, but I think that, again, the home and school or personal life and school and the values and how you bridge that would be really helpful.
Yeah, I mean, I think that you all are, you know, we at my day job at George Mason University, we get students at 18 to, you know, 20 or two or even older, but you know, there are a lot of ways formed by the time they arrive on campus, and you are seeing sort of what that formation process looks like. And it was interesting that the speaker before me is, you know, bringing into question, you know, George Mason and who he was and his legacy and all of those things. It's almost as if it sat in on meetings that we've had on campus around these same issues. So it's you know, the way that we've attacked that is by trying to study sort of what that legacy looks like and talking about our namesake as a university in fullness. And some of the, you know, the ways that maybe we can, you know, talk about some of those conversations around sort of music and what the impact of it is, even some of the more objectionable pieces to it. Is there meaning there? Is there something that person is speaking to us? I think it's about sort of trying to study in full, but I think that would be a good, you know, something for us to talk about during our individual meetings as well.
Mr. Anderson?
I just want to make sure everybody else has a chance. Okay. Well, I just want to say thank you for coming tonight, and thank you for taking this on. I'm really glad to see this emphasis. We've had this growing emphasis, but I'm glad to see this next step, because honestly, I'm really concerned with some of the events we've had recently and sort of our national context about a big disconnect between what we've said are our aspirations and our goals and our policies and our practices of diversity and inclusion and what people are actually really experiencing and what we're seeing in this town. And so this really worries me personally, I don't know. So I'm looking forward to talking with you about it.
Absolutely.
And getting your feedback, your advice, and see how we can make that gap a lot smaller and get us
Absolutely.
Experiencing what we want people to have as our aspirations being our reality.
Absolutely. And I think these are issues that in homogeneous communities, I think one of some of the things that FCCPS is experiencing are byproducts of the diversity from a multitude of perspectives that you have. Now, I think what we're talking about now is sort of what inclusion looks like in that, which is a further step, takes time to get there. But I think the intentionality of even, you know, us having this conversation now is a good first step. And then what I hope to do is to provide a roadmap for the school division to sort of move along that will help sort of get down the line there as well.
Yes, Mr. Webb.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And I, as with Mr. Anderson just said, shared some of the same concerns that I sent with the superintendent and he shared with the board that it is becoming alarming to me of some of the incidents that we've had over the last couple of years, it feels like, in our schools with and around race, race as well as religion, that it makes me concerned, and it seems to have been across the board, but seems to be concentrated a little bit more within the middle school level, it seems mm-hmm. like. And that makes me a little bit more concerned of where are we at now on a path, because looking at society right now, a lot more things are happening than have happened in a number of years of most of my growing up. I've never really, can't say that I've never experienced, but it was a rarity. And I grew up in rural Virginia, that it was a rarity to kind of for those type of things to happen. But now seeing more and more people are, for lack of a better word, are exposing themselves in that, and sometimes the way they really feel about situations. And quite frankly, I feel the current administration kind of has given people, emboldened some folks a little bit more. So, but I think it's I'm glad that we are making an effort now to address this and bringing you in to help us, as well as I think our community as a whole, absolutely. Because it's not only our responsibility to try to address this, but it's a responsibility of our community, starting in individual students, families, household, to have conversations of what's acceptable and what's not acceptable when you're interacting with folks from different backgrounds than you. And I think at least this is a small starting point for us to have a dialogue and a conversation about it, because it's, if we don't do it and things like this continue to happen, it just puts us in a position where things, it's going to become what I hope doesn't come. I've lived in Falls Church for over 10 years now, and it has always been a very welcoming community for myself and my partner, but I don't want to feel our community is shifting, and hopefully making this, addressing this does get us on the right path to being the community that we all want to live in.
Absolutely. Thank you. And I agree.
So I just have one quick question. First of all, I'm really happy you're going to be working with us. Very thankful for your efforts so far. Falls Church City is generally a pretty politically liberal community, but I have heard from some constituents who are more conservative, mm-hmm. and they also feel like they're not as included in the community. So I was just wondering, like, will that also be addressed as part of this? Some people say, like, listen, I feel like I can't, and I'm definitely more on the liberal side, but people say, listen, I feel like I can't express my conservative views because everyone here is so liberal, so I feel excluded now. Is that something that we'll be wrapping into this as well?
Absolutely. I mean, it's something that impacts my sort of day-to-day day work. I see inclusion and diversity work as encompassing everyone. Now, you know, depending on your perspective or political leanings and all those things, there may be a different conversation, but there's a seat at the table for you, regardless of where you're coming from. And I see that same thing as we undertake this work as well, that there's a seat at the table for everyone in these conversations. And I would invite those that may have felt marginalized wherever they are and for whatever reason to engage in this process as well.
Thanks.
Yeah. So I want to start by saying that I think this is really important and really awesome that this is going forward, but I'm really interested to know what this will look like from a student perspective in terms of how much students will be involved in all of this process and then what it will look like going forward once sure. this is all done.
Sure, that's a great question. So I would hope to speak with students and meet with students, whether it's in if there's sort of larger levels of student leadership or various constituent groups as well. And as far as impact, I see it, much of it will depend on sort of the plan and process and implementation moving forward. But my hope is that this would have an impact on the learning environment for students, that, you know, it may involve sort of a different level of professional development, maybe for some of the teachers, or thinking about what that looks like within, which then could have an impact on what the learning environment would look like for students, or maybe asking the school division to think critically and intentionally around some of those, the things that Dr. Noonan mentioned around celebrations, and maybe who's included traditionally and who's excluded from some of those traditional celebrations, and then that having an impact on sort of what the learning environment for students could look like as well. So my hope would be to hear from students and to sit down and speak with them, and then also hopefully the work having a downstream impact on what that sort of day-to-day could look like for students. Because I think that's where there's a qualitative piece to this, is this sort of how comfortable do I feel in my classroom or interacting with my classmates around some of the issues that have been brought up. And that is really the focus of the work. And from my sense, if you start the work at a high level around some of these large issues, you can have an effect on that experienced piece as well.
I just wanted to say one last thing, that, and sort of harkening back to the conversations with the principals and decision-making processes around the budget and the like, you will see in our triennial plan that there is language in our triennial plan that will work on these kinds of issues. So it's linked to that triennial plan. And in the placemat, one of the pieces that we're really going to focus on this coming year as well is in this idea of being a caring community, having a caring culture and community. And I think that this fits in very nicely to that work as well. So it's, again, just sort of aligned to the bigger picture.
Any further comments or questions? If not, we really look forward to working with
you.
And thank you so much for coming out tonight.
Thank you. Thank you.
All right, next on the agenda is Section 8.02, our Special Education Annual Plan.
I'm going to invite up Rebecca Sharp, who's our Director of Special Services, and I'd like to thank her for her work on this Special Ed Annual Plan, but also she'll reference the work of the Special Ed Advisory and their role in this, as well as, we've got Seamus here tonight, and who's been a big part of it as well. So with that, Rebecca, I will turn it over to you, but this is just a checkpoint, if you will, before it gets submitted to the state.
All right. It's very nice to be here. This is my one-year anniversary meeting you all, so I'm really excited. So I moved here, and then I think I was on the job for a week and had to present to you all. So I'm here back again this year, and we're going to talk about the Special Education Annual Plan. And really what we have to do as a division is to address how we're going to spend our IDEA federal dollars in special education. And you all already received the report, the actual plan itself to review. The big chunk of it, well, I think I went the wrong way, sorry. The big chunk of it is really what we're going to do with those federal dollars and what that money looks like each year. The components of the plan are the superintendent certification, then there are general policy statements. We also have to address how, if we have identified any barriers in our division to implementing services in an equitable manner, which we have not. The other piece that we have to identify is if we provide special education services, if there is a jail that's located with our NARB division and we don't do that. The other piece is we have to reflect on what we did with the money, funds we received last year. And so the funds that we received last year for our school age students, we supported the salary and benefits for 4.5 special education teachers. And then through the preschool funds that we received from the federal government, we supported 0.12 of a special education preschool teacher. And our goal for this upcoming year is that we continue with that work. And as you may have noted when you reviewed the annual plan, we really are implementing the exact same plan. We want to continue our support using these funds to pay for the salary and benefits for our staff. So that's what this plan that we are proposing to submit is, utilizing those funds in the same manner. And one of the reasons why the annual plan for Falls Church looks the way it does is really because of the commitment here to maintaining a lower teacher-student ratio for our students with disabilities. And so you can see on this slide that our 611 grant funds, we received a small increase from the federal government in terms of our funding, but it still goes to fund 4.5 special ed teachers. And you can see the 619, which are preschool funds, that again goes to fund a portion of a special ed teacher at JTP. And utilizing our funds in this way allows smaller caseloads for our teachers. It also allows us to really provide and hone in on strong specially designed instruction for our special needs students, and really allows us to focus on the outcomes for our kids with disabilities. So it is with that that I respectfully submit our annual plan to you. Here's our timeline. We worked with several groups and looked at collaboration planning. And then last night I presented the plan to our special ed advisory committee. And this evening it goes to you guys for acceptance and approval. And then it has to be submitted to the Virginia Department of Education by Friday. Does anyone have any questions?
No, any questions? Yes, Ms. Russell.
Just first of all, thank you so much for putting this together. I know it's a tremendous amount of work, and it's a lot of administration that you have to do on top of trying to keep on top of the classrooms and the students, so I really appreciate that. But one is just a curiosity. What does LEA, what does that stand for? Is it local education? I don't know. I couldn't figure out what the acronym was.
You almost had the whole thing.
Okay. what's the A? So local education.
Agency.
Got it. Thank you.
I know, and I'm like looking through here trying to find the acronym.
And it's important to get this through tonight so that we can send it to our SEA, which is our state education agency.
Any further questions? No. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Have a good night. Next on the agenda. Oh, we have to vote for it. Sorry. Yes. Okay. Would someone please move to approve the special education annual plan as presented?
I move that we approve the special education.
Thanks, Ms. Russell. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? All right. Now we will move on to section 8.03, National Mental Health Awareness Month proclamation. And I will turn over to Dr. Noonan, and then to Ms. Russell, who brought this to our attention. She would please read the proclamation.
Yeah, well, first of all, I want to thank Ms. Russell for bringing it to our attention, and thank Rebecca Sharp, our Director of Student Services, for helping pull together this resolution on behalf, or proclamation for the board. It is National Mental Health Month, and that's not to suggest that we only pay attention to mental health during this time of year, but again, through the really great support of the board, we continue to have a strong school social work program, a strong school psychologist program. Our school counseling program is very strong here as well. And we actually exceed the standards of quality that the state puts forward, so that our students do have access to professionals to support them when they need the help. In addition to that, as Ms. Russell will read in the proclamation, this year we started something new, and it, under the leadership of Rebecca Sharp, Mental Health First Aid, where we've done a number of trainings with our parents and with staff. When the students of that class complete that class, whether they're teachers or parents, particularly teachers, they get a lanyard that's green, and they can hang their badge from that. like the one Ms. Minson is wearing, that actually, in the other side, it says something on it. It says, I am a certified youth mental health first aid provider, essentially. And so students that may be in crisis, if they see that green lanyard, can go talk to someone and know that they have had the training necessary to get the resources in place for them. So anyway, I just want to thank the board for your continued support of making sure that our students are emotionally safe as well as physically safe. And thank Ms. Russell again for bringing this up.
Ms. Russell, if you wouldn't mind reading the proclamation.
Sure. First, thank I just you. Wanted to make a comment that one of the committees that I serve on is the Health and Wellness Advisory Committee, and this is one of the issues that they're very concerned about. So they've been trying to do a lot of programming this year, and we'll continue to do it next year with regard to speakers and the whatnot to address these issues. So that was one of the key drivers for me in terms of their work on this. So with that, sorry, Proclamation 0119, National Mental Health Awareness Month. Whereas May 2019 marks the 70th anniversary of Mental Health Awareness Month celebrated in the United States, and whereas addressing the complex mental health needs of children, youth, and families today is fundamental to the healthy future of Falls Church City Public Schools, and whereas the need for comprehensive, coordinated mental health services for children, youth, young adults, and families places upon our community a critical responsibility, and whereas every citizen in our school community can help end the silence and stigma surrounding mental illness, and whereas Falls Church City Public Schools provides ongoing school-based mental health support services via our counselors, school psychologists, social workers, and behavior specialists to students pre-K through 12th grade for students and their families, and whereas Falls Church City Public Schools offers the nationally recognized Youth Mental Health First Aid course, which provides certification as first responders for both staff and parents to respond when students are having mental health concerns. Each person who is certified wears a green lanyard as a symbol to our students that this person is there to help you during a time of emotional need. And whereas we recognize that Mental Health Awareness Month is an opportunity to increase public understanding of the importance of mental health and to promote the identification and treatment of mental illness. Now, therefore, the Falls Church City School Board does hereby recognize May 2019 as Mental Health Awareness Month in our Falls Church City Public Schools, and we call this observance to the attention of all of our staff, students, and families.
Thank you, Ms. Russell. Would someone please move to approve the proclamation?
I move that the Falls Church City Public School Board approve Proclamation 01-19 National Mental Health Awareness Month as presented.
Second. Thank you, Mr. Webb. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstain? Thank you very much. Now on to 8.04, adoption of the 2019-2020 school operating budget.
Thank you, Madam Chair.
And
Does Mr.
briefly, Mr. Anderson will
like to make a statement.
Yes.
Yeah, okay.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I have consulted with the school board attorney and am making the following disclosure of interest pursuant to Virginia Code 2.2-3112B1. Pursuant to Virginia Code 2.2-3115H, I have a personal interest in the school board budget in that my spouse is an employee of the Falls Church City School Board, and I am a member of a group of three or more persons affected by budget decisions. I am able to participate in the transaction fairly, objectively, and in the public interest.
Thank you, Mr. Anderson. Dr. Noonan?
All right. Thank you again. Before I go into this presentation, which actually is the same presentation that I presented to you 2 weeks ago, or last week. So if you are comfortable, we could dispense with the presentation, or I could, yes? Okay. All right. Well, let me make a comment then and a statement about the budget. But before I do, I want to thank a few people for their incredible work on that, on this budget. And first is Michelle Kopic, our budget director. Michelle has put in incredible hours and really sacrificed a lot of home time to really work through this budget and get all of the pennies aligned on both sides of the ledger. And we thank you very much for your incredible support pulling this together and doing the hard work and the legwork behind it. I would be remiss if I didn't thank Kristen Michael as well. Kristen is our chief operating officer and has really led this school budget process from a staff perspective in a way that is second to none. It was this time last year Kristen came in and was kind of picking up a budget that had pretty much been sort of run through some other people and was able to pick it up and kind of work through it. So this is really her first budget that is all hers. And I think it's the best one of the 2 years we've had a budget with me. So anyway, I want to thank Kristen for her incredible work as well. Lisa High has been incredible working through some of the hard conversations around curriculum and instruction with respect to the budget and positions and the like, talking about how we're making sure that we're within planning factors, and has been very supportive of that. And just the entire staff has been really great. And then lastly, I just want to thank the board. You all have been really great partners in this process. And have again sort of made a strong commitment and statement to the staff and faculty in the City of Falls Church Schools that they matter and they make a difference in the lives of kids. And you did that by ensuring that their compensation is consistently and regionally strong, and provides us then an opportunity to recruit, retain, and train the very best that are out there. Again, coming back from the Virginia Association of School Superintendents this week and talking about teacher shortage and talking about how school divisions are dealing with that, I have to sort of sit in that room a little bit like a shrinking violet, because if I engage in the conversation, I get run out on a rail, because we do a really great job here of making sure that our teachers are compensated in ways that allow us to attract the best. So when we have positions that are open, in English or in social studies and the like, we're able to fill those positions pretty easily. There are some other positions that are harder to fill, but they're just harder to fill across the state. But when there are people that want to come to Northern Virginia, they look to us right away. And so your commitment to making sure that that happens is really, really great. A couple of fundamental things in this budget that I just want to put out there on the table again is that even though we were interested in making sure that we maintain this compensation for all of our employees, there was a backside cut to it. And there were some pieces that we had to really sort of tighten down on. And as part of this process, we did really scrutinize our enrollment numbers. We scrutinized very closely our class sizes. And we've been able to do the work without increasing the planning factors and without pushing on the planning factors too hard either. So we don't anticipate that we'll have classes that will exceed the planning factors that you all have adopted as a consequence of reducing some staff within this budget. And I think that that's a good place to be. But I will caution the board that this is now year two of really going line by line. We did it last year, went line by line. This year we did it again line by line, and this year we cut positions. And I don't know that there's anywhere else to go for money moving forward. So if we have more students that come to the City of Falls Church, which we do expect, the cost of the budget is going to go up. If we want to continue to compensate teachers the way that we've been compensating them, that is a cost that is going to rise as well. And so we will continue to look at the City Council for their partnership, like we did this year and have in the past. And I personally want to thank Wyatt Shields and the City Council for their support of our budget as well, and think that they've been great partners this year, and we hope that they will continue to be great partners now and into the future. So with that, Madam Chair, I'm recommending that you adopt 8.04, 8.05, and 8.06, which are the school operating budgets, school food services fund, and the community services budget as well.
Any questions for Dr. Noonan? If not, would someone like to please make the motion to adopt the operating fund budget?
Madam Chair, I move that the school board adopt the 2019-2020 school operating fund budget in the amount of $52,300,119. Requiring a city appropriation of $43,255,777.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Lydon. Do we do them all once and then do one final? Or should we do each one?
I think we've done them.
We need to
individually.
Each one individually. Do you want to take a roll for them, or do you want to, since it's the budget? Okay.
Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Mr. Castillo is not here. Ms. Gill?
Yes.
Ms. Litton?
Yes.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
Ms. Russell?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Thank you.
Okay. Let's do it for that one. Okay, next, would someone please move to adopt the school food services budget?
I move that the school board adopt the 2019-20 school food service budget with receipts and disbursements in the amount of $1,103,600.
Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. All those in favor?
Yes.
Yes. I was just going to do a roll for the main budget, yeah. If we don't need to do it for all. Yeah. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Next is the adoption of the community services budget.
Madam Chair, I move the school board adopt the 2019-20 community services fund budget in the amount of $2,419,126, requiring a total city appropriation of $107,500.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Is there a second?
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? Great. Thank you very much. and thank you to everyone who worked on the budget. Your hard work is noticed by the community and by us. Thank you. Yes, Mr. Webb?
Just very quickly, I want to thank Chair Gill on her shepherding this budget through without having to have a very big knockdown drawout this year. It was a very good year to get a budget that did not require us to have to do a lot of politicking, I will say, that we were able to, with the help of the staff, crafting a budget that worked within the guidance and still got done what we needed to get done this year. And I really want to show my appreciation to the staff and you and your leadership this year.
Thank you, Mr. I'll say all credit goes to staff for providing us with a budget that was very easy and politically non-controversial. So thank you all. Move on to 8.07, which is the approval of first reading of policies. Ms. Minson.
Good evening. We have one policy for first reading tonight, and I'll invite Amy Hall, the Director of Human Resources, to join us if there are questions on this policy. I'm incredibly grateful to Ms. Hall's help in working through this. The policy is moving from our policy 8.91 to model policy GCBE, which is Family Medical Leave Act. It will be the policy, as you can see on board docs, is a 15-page policy and then has another full page of attachment. So it's a pretty dense policy, and Ms. Hall spent a lot of time looking through our policy, our practice, our regs, how we do things, and looking at this to determine what would this move to the model policy mean. And there's some high-level things I wanted to share with you, and to the extent the board has questions about either the words in the policy or how we do things now, Ms. Hall is available to answer those and any other things that come up. Just the review of the policy itself. The last page does have a link to forms and attachments. These are the federal resources that would be available for all staff. It's the same thing that we give staff members when they make inquiries about FMLA, but we think it makes sense to include it at the get-go. So if someone has questions or wants to have resources, they're all right there and available. Moving to the model policy would not change our practice of what we do under FMLA. We do think that the model policy makes it more clear, particularly since the last line of our policy does say if there are variations between our policy and the federal law, the variations will be determined in favor of federal law. As usual, the red line version that I prepared for the board tonight shows the changes to the VSBA model policies. A few notes on that. At page 3, at the top of the page, in our previous policy, 8.91, the board has extended FMLA leave to individuals within the employees' family for whom they may receive leave. We went ahead and incorporated language from 8.91 in here. So you'll notice that rather than just being allowed to have leave under FMLA for the care of a spouse, parent, or child, there's more individuals that would be supported with if the board does choose to keep the language from policy 8.91 and add that to GCBE. On page 13, there also was language reflecting leave that's available for a husband and wife. That's because it's modeled after the federal law. We propose changing that to married couples employed by Falls Church City Public Schools, and we also changed the language on page 14. Under the federal law, an employer who employs individuals who are married can limit the 12 weeks collectively among the employees. Our policy had explicitly stated that each employee gets 12 weeks of leave. So we have modified the model policy to allow that larger, longer amount of leave for employees who are spouses. Our policy had not been clear about the eligibility for FMLA leave for part-time employees, so we think the new policy, clearly following federal law, will make it more consistent in implementation. And the law, just so you all know, as is reflecting the policy, is you must be an employee for at least 12 months of service and have worked at least 200 or 1250 hours in the preceding 12-month period. So we think the language in the model policy and the definition of year really cleans things up and will make sure that we consistently implement this policy. Our policy also requires a response within 2 business days to a request for FMLA leave, whereas on page 4, line 6 now gives us 5 business days. We do get a lot of these requests, and sometimes there are a lot of pieces and moving parts to it. And frankly, this will allow us to make sure that we fully respond to requests in the timely manner that the policy requires. A few other differences between the model policy and our current policy. On page 4, there's a notice of rights and responsibilities that had previously been provided in separate documents to employees when they wanted to know what our leave policy was. We think, again, it makes sense to include in the policy. On page 13 of the policy, if the employee fails to return to work at the time that the doctor has indicated would be appropriate, the school board can now expressly recover for a premium paid for maintaining the employee's insurance coverage. We think that's a valuable addition, and that is something that was not included in our policy previously. And I do want to note, on page 15, there is a footnote that states that school boards who determine that they'll exclude individuals from working at other jobs while they're on FMLA should have a non-school employment by staff members policy. We do have that policy currently at 8.58, but we think it makes sense, since we're moving the model policies, to move to the GCQA policy. So I'll work with Ms. Hall on getting that ready for first reading for next month if that works. And finally, it's my understanding that Ms. Hall and Ms. Michael will be sharing this policy, assuming that you all approve it for first reading. We'll be sharing GCBE with staff members at Peak, Seek, and Eat to let them know that while this is a change that's coming, and here's the language, and you're welcome to it, it's on board docs, and we're available to answer questions. We don't think that it's going to change substantially what we do here at CO and processing FMLA claims, but we do think that there's language in here that's more clear of who gets leave when, how it's calculated, what documents that they use. So it's a pretty meaty policy, and I prefer Ms. Hall questions that you have about our current practices, if any.
I have one question. On page 3, line 3, where we add a number of specific other things, do we expect that to have much impact? Like, will more people be taking FMLA due to that?
I don't know that we expect a great, though we had already provided the leave for those members already. Just glancing at them, I wouldn't say that most probably fall outside of that, but in the interest of supporting our employees, we thought keeping those as well was a good idea.
Mr. Anderson?
Wouldn't be policy discussion without me having questions. So I have some questions that are about the wording of the policy, but then actually some questions about practice and sort of what are these implications. So I'll ask them, and then hopefully we get them in the right place. But anyway, I was very glad to see the revision that had the replacement of husband and wife with married couple. But I'm curious, and it's just because I don't remember what the other policies say about leave. What do our other leave policies say in terms of married couples, in terms of partners that are not married couples? I'm just really curious, do we have other categories?
Our leave policies are the next big ones that Ms. Hall and I want to look at. We have, I think, 3 policies that address leave and 18 regulations about different types of leave that haven't been revised for a while. I don't.
So we do think that in number three, other people living in the household will cover that situation while we're going through other leave policies. But our intention is that would cover anyone who's in that household.
Okay. Yeah. So I'm glad to see the change from the federal language. But so I just want to make sure that when we're going through, to make sure we're carrying that same, because I think that would be very much in keeping with our other non-discrimination policies. On a purely linguistic thing, we stop saying FCCPS on about page 4 and then go to the division. I don't know if it does anything other than just it's what the model policy says. So I don't know if it's worth doing a global search and replace kind of a thing or not, but there's on page 2, there's in the series of definitions on page 2, there's a definition of serious health condition, and then there's a definition of serious injury or illness, which appears to apply only to either current or veteran members of the armed forces. Is that a distinction that causes any trouble for us? Or, I mean, because I'm just sort of trying to figure out, would serious injury or illness also just be covered under serious health condition for someone who isn't either an active duty member or a veteran? And does it matter? And I guess I don't know if this is something that has come across in any actual cases.
So the reason the definition of, starting at line 23, serious injury or illness, as far as a member of the reserves, there's different federal law for the amount of leave that individuals can take if they're a member of the military or supporting someone who is a member of the military. And that's also reflected starting at page 10 for leave to care for a covered service member.
Right.
So there's additional time of, rather than the 12 weeks FMLA leave, there's 26 weeks for care of a service member. So I think the term serious injury or illness is reflective of the federal law that provides additional protections for individuals or family members who are members of the armed forces.
Okay, thanks. And then on page 14, and I saw this may be a question that you're best suited to answer sort of practicality-wise, but there's a whole series of return-to-work provisions with if the leave is taken within this certain window of time before the end of the school year, then they have to do the following sorts of things. I'm sort of curious what the intent behind that is.
That language allows us to, if, for example, a teacher were on leave and were scheduled to return from leave a week before school got out, could possibly be more disruptive to the classroom to bring a teacher back rather than leave a long-term substitute in place for an additional week. So this language allows us the flexibility to say, rather than have you come back into that position, we either stay out on leave if you're talking about a week, for example, or even we could have that person, someone else were out, substitute for another class rather than going back into the exact position that they were in, just in terms of keeping consistency within the classroom, as an example.
Okay, thanks. That helps.
Yes, Ms. Russell.
I just want to extend a huge thank you to Ms. Hall and Ms. Minson for this is a monster policy. There's a lot of complexities, and I think you guys did a fantastic job of putting this together and going through it. So thank you very much, because I think it's very important for our employees. And so giving it this kind of a time and attention and making sure that we have everything ticked and tied is fantastic. So thank you.
Quick question engendered. I hadn't looked as much detail until Mr. Anderson asked his question on page 2, line 34. The third bullet, it starts with a paren B, close paren. Is there an A with that?
No, I suspect that the B goes with 29 U.S.C. section 26, 11, 15,
Yeah, I thought there might be just an inadvertent bullet there, but it was a little confusing.
Go back to the VSBA model policy and see, but that's a good catch. Thank you.
Trying to add value.
I think that adds value. Thanks.
There are If there are no further questions or comments, would someone please move to approve the first reading? Mr. Webb?
Madam Chair, I move that the school board approve first reading of policy GCBE, family and medical leave.
Thank you, Mr. Webb. Is there a second?
Second.
Mr. Redinger, thank you. All those in favor?
Yes.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained? All right, next is 8.08, approval of second reading and adoption of policies. Ms. Minson?
All right, we have two readings for second, or two policies for second reading tonight. The first is policy IEC, Bill of Rights of the Constitution of the United States. We talked about this at the last meeting. There are no proposed changes. This doesn't replace the current policy, but is in line with our practice of posting the Bill of Rights in each of our schools. Questions on IEC? Hearing none. The second policy is policy IGBF, limited English proficient students. This would replace our current policy 6.27. And there were no proposed changes from the board from last reading. And I did confirm with Dr. Santiago that this is consistent with what our practices are and with what the law requires. So I think it's fairly straightforward, but happy to answer any questions on the IGBF.
There are no questions or comments on these policies. Would someone approve second reading and adoption?
Madam Chair, I move that the school board approve second reading of the adoption of the following policies. IEC, Bill of Rights of the Constitution of the United States, and IGBF, Limited English Proficient Students.
Thank you, Mr. Redinger. Second?
Second.
Oh, thank you, Ms. Litton. All those in favor?
Yes.
Opposed? Abstained? Great. Okay. Moving on to 8.09, our third reading and adoption of policy KQ.
Adoption, she says.
Adoption. Policy KQ.
So policy for third reading, this is my first time presenting a policy for third reading of the board, and you all have spent a great amount of time at, this is now our third board meeting, and we had three work sessions to talk about policy KQ. The changes that are in red line are those that were made at the April board's work session. The main ones worth pointing out would be I do need on page 2 input from the board on whether it would be 3 or 5 school years for the superintendent to approve a sponsorship or partnership. There'd been talk about limiting the superintendent's approval for extending an agreement for more than 1 year, but not having it exceed either 3 or 5 years. So that would be one where if I could get the consensus of the board, that would be incorporated when it's edited for posting. The other point, need to thank Mr. Redinger for bringing up following the work session in April, I've added policy exception starting at line 25 on page 5, saying the policy does not apply to ticket sales or student fundraising. And Mr. Redinger brought up the point should it also be concession sales. And I think that makes sense. Often that's done by SAOs, but it's something that that doesn't make sense to include as part of the agreement, written agreement between the school board and the SAOs for fundraising. So I would, in addition to getting your feedback on 3 to 5 years, if the policy is adopted, would suggest that there be an edit to say should not apply to ticket sales, concession sales, or student fundraising.
Should we also include spirit wear? I don't want to make this too broad, but like.
Would you consider that concession?
Would you consider that concession? Can you consider that?
I think concessions
okay.
is broad enough. That
anything?
We could probably.
Great.
Pull some other things in.
Okay, perfect. Any comments on the 3 versus 5 years discussion? Yes, Mr. Webb.
Five.
We have 1 vote for 5.
Three.
I think I suggested 3 based on making sure that we didn't have a complete turnover of board members in the amount of time that the sponsorship was in place. I don't know. Anyone? Anyone?
I like 3.
3?
Sorry.
Sorry, Lawrence. All right. I think we have a consensus of three.
Are there any other questions about policy KQ? I know we spent a lot of time talking about it, but
Mr. Wright. There was also an issue.
Sorry.
I think it should be 3 school years, not 3 schools years.
Yes. Thank you. The other change that came out of the April work session is reflected on page 4 at line 19, the so-called morals provision. We've removed the language saying failed to act with due regard for social convention, public morals, and decency, and instead the proposed language was act in a way inconsistent with school board mission, vision, policies, and regulation. So that was a change that we spent a lot of time talking about, but I think looks good and makes sense and wraps this policy in with the board's other policies.
Any further comments before we adopt this policy? Mr. Dr. Noonan?
I just would thank the board for your work on this. This has not been an easy one to navigate, and I think what you're adopting tonight may be imperfect, and we'll find out relatively quickly, but we can always come back and ask you to modify the policy. So I think to get something on the record would be a good idea.
And speaking of imperfections, I will add an S to the word regulations on line 20. Thank you, Ms. Munson.
Thank you, Ms. Munson. If there is no further discussion of this policy at this time, would someone move to approve third reading and adoption?
Madam Chair, sorry. I move that the school board finally approve third reading and adoption of policy KQ as presented.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger.
Second.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Okay, oppose, abstain. Great. Thank you so much for your work on this policy, especially Ms. Minson, all your hard work. Next item on our business agenda is 8.10 GMP1 report.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'm going to invite up Daisy Brangman, our school's representative with Brailsford and Dunleavy. She was here not too long ago and shared some information about the upcoming GMP1, and I welcome her back to kind of do another brief overview of kind of what we're looking at, what we're looking forward to in GMP1. So, Ms. Brangman, I'll turn it over to you.
Hi, good evening, everybody. So with respect to the actual GMP, there haven't been any substantial changes from what was last reviewed or shared with the school board. We are in discussions with Gilbane on some of the terms, as is available with at this stage of the project with the GMP amendment. We do have the ability to kind of review some of the terms, make sure that all the terminology is correct in the comprehensive agreement. So that's currently what we're undergoing, just to make sure that we're getting the best value for the schools. In collaboration with Ms. Minson and also William Devan, your outside counsel for the construction project. On the comprehensive agreement, just to summarize, there's just a couple of items that we're looking at and we're better defining in the comprehensive agreement, including the phases. So because we're kind of building the project in phases, where you're going to get the building and then you're going to get the fields, and then there's, you know, the area that borders the economic development. So we want to make sure that we're clearly defining when each of those elements needs to be complete, what the dates are, and also what the liquidated damages are, if any, as well as the final phase of the project, and also building in language that ties it to the economic development, since they're correlated with the demolition of the existing high school and then the build out of the east portion of the building. So it's just really working through that. With that is also just pinning down the actual definition of substantial completion. What are we expecting from Gilbane in terms of what will be complete on whether it's December or June 2021, and also what elements will not be complete by that date, and then when will they be complete, what defines substantial completion and the ability to occupy and use the building in December or June. Cleaning up some of the scope of work just as they shifted throughout the project, so one being testing and inspections. Previously, Gilbane was responsible for materials testing and inspection. Through conversations with city planning and zoning, we have been informed that that has to be carried by the owner. So we've shifted that scope of work from Gilbane to the owner, so cleaning up the language as to what they're responsible for, what we're responsible for, how it's going to be managed and defined. Removal of the language regarding demolition and salvage, and just cleaning up what the responsibilities are there, since currently the demolition of the existing school is going to be the responsibility of the economic development. More administrative items like the schedule format, how they're required to report their schedule, what the information is, what the level of detail is, the duration of individual activities, and then also correction period. So that's just a brief summary. We have multiple matrices going on between Ms. Minson, Gilbane, and the rest of the team, just to kind of pin down all these items. And over the next few days, we're going to be very actively working with them closely to pin everything down and get to a final agreement as to what the comprehensive agreement, the GMP amendment, and the GMP itself is going to look like, which will also define a lot of the terms that will be in GMP 2. So it'll be a lot less work coming to GMP 2.
Okay, I'm going to open up to the board for questions for Ms. Bregman. I have one. Do you think we're going to be ready to sign the GMP 1 on Tuesday? What's your sense?
That's what we're working toward, yes.
Okay, and what are the ramifications if we are not able to sign it? I know the City Council is working really hard with EYAMP and Hoffman, but what are our options if we get to Tuesday and we're not able to sign the GMP, or they haven't reached a comprehensive agreement by then?
Yeah, I'll take that one. I just want to sort of in response to your first question is, yeah, not only are we working on it, but yes, we'll be ready. And I want to be a little bit more emphatic about, you know, the work that we've been doing with them, the fact that we have such great partners with Gilbane, and we've been working really closely with Brailsford and Dunleavy and the excellent outside counsel of William Devan. And we've been highly engaged in these discussions, and I really believe we're going to get it across the line and be ready for Tuesday. We have a big workout session actually scheduled for Friday, it looks like. We're hoping to have the final workout session on Friday, Thursday, to get through some of these final pieces. And with respect to your second question, we really, again, sort of value and appreciate greatly the work of the City Council and what they're doing to get their comprehensive agreement signed with EYAP and Hoffman. But in the event that they're not ready to sign the CA on Monday, there are some options that we need to kind of pay attention to, because of the shared fiscal commitment that we have between the two entities, the General Government, City Council, and the School Board. So it's important that our partners in the city understand, and I think they do understand the need for them to complete their work on Monday so that we can move forward on Tuesday. I want to just sort of put out there that signing GMP 1 doesn't require City Council action. That's a School Board action. However, we've said all along that we want to really go into this work as partners and really partner around this, because the work that we're doing is in many ways predicated on the work they're doing, because the economic development is going to help support and fund a portion of the high school. So we are very, very hopeful that next Monday they will be able to have their work completed, so they'll be able to sign their comprehensive agreement so that we can move forward on Tuesday. There are some ramifications. If we don't go forward on Tuesday, so the challenge right now is the schedule. And the schedule in a school is different than the schedule of an office building in many ways, because our kids aren't in the building in the summer. And there's an awful lot of mobilization that needs to happen in this first summer to get some of the large equipment in, and the timing of it's really important so that we can get started, so that we can actually make the move in the December 2020, January 2021 timeline. If things get pushed, the timeline shifts. And it doesn't slide like 2 weeks or 3 weeks that would be consistent with the slide of a GMP. It actually slides months. And the reason that it slides months is because schools are not nimble enough to make a move in February or in March. You know, we have big equipment, we have kids, you know, 1,000 kids that need to pick up and move. And so we would be looking then at probably a July, early July, late June move of 2021. In addition to that, there are some fiscal ramifications that we also need to kind of put on our radar. And those fiscal ramifications would be multiple mobilizations, because we would be coming in doing part of the work at the end of the summer as opposed to the beginning of the summer. So every time there's a remobilization, there's a charge, there's escalation of costs, there's additional fees. We have an outstanding working relationship with Brailsford and Dunleavy and with Gilbane and Stantec and Quinn Evans. And if the project gets pushed, we potentially could have a different team that would be coming back in to reorganize the project if we get pushed out of our timeline. So there are some significant challenges economically that we would face. And so if for example, we were pushed and we didn't have an opportunity to move ahead, we know instantly there's about a $3 million delta right off the bat. And that $3 million would need to come out of scope of the high school, or it would be an additional cost to the project. And that's just on the school side. The economic development team wouldn't be able to take the property until late summer of 2021 or early fall of 2021 if we got pushed also. Right now, it looks like they'll be able to take the property in January of 2021. And start demolition of the high school shortly thereafter. And that could potentially have some downstream economic development consequences as well. So, you know, in the end, we're working really hard on both sides to get this work done. And so we're cautiously optimistic that it's all going to kind of, as Mary Beth would say, sort of the zipper is coming together. I don't know if it's the greatest analogy, but it is one that has worked for a while. So we're optimistic that the council will get their work done and be ready to go next Monday with a comprehensive agreement so that we can move ahead with our work on Tuesday.
Thank you for that update. And I know several of us were in the council meeting till 12:30 last night, and they were working very, very hard. It was a really good collaborative meeting. Any other comments from the board, questions?
I would make one more comment just to sort of put it out there. We, in anticipation of next Tuesday signing of the GMP, we are looking at holding the school board meeting at the high school. We'll have a cake because we think it'll be a really great night of celebration. And Gilbane, or not Gilbane, but Stantec has commissioned a three-dimensional model of the high school. And we'll have it for next Tuesday's meeting. And it's not just the high school, but it's the whole site as well. And so it'll be the unveiling of the three-dimensional model that evening as well. So lots to celebrate next Tuesday with the signing of the GMP.
It's really exciting.
Yeah.
I've been working on this since I ran for office. So it's exciting to see this happening. And Mr. Ridinger has as well. And Mr. Webb for even longer. So we don't have any action on this item. If there's no other questions, thank you, Daisy. The next item on our agenda is another closed meeting. And for members of the audience, after we come out of closed meeting, there's no other business. So while you're welcome to stick around, there won't be any new business coming after the closed meeting. Would someone please read us into closed?
Pursuant to the Virginia Freedom of Information Act, I move that the board convene a closed meeting for the following purpose, to discuss or consider the identified subject matter, the award of a public contract involving the expenditure of public funds, including interviews of bidders or offerers, and discussions of the term or scope of such contract, where discussion in an open session would adversely affect the bargaining position or negotiating strategy of the public body, pursuant to Section 2.2-3711A 29, in particular, GMP-1 review and legal matters under Section 2.2-3711A 7, in particular, consultation with legal counsel employed or retained by the public body regarding specific legal matters requiring the provision of legal advice by such counsel.
Thank you, Ms. Litton. Is there a second?
Second.
Second.
Thank you, Mr. Reitinger.
Yes. Mr. Anderson?
Yes.
Ms. Gill?
Aye.
Ms. Litton?
Yeah. Aye.
Mr. Reitinger?
Yes.
Ms. Russell?
Yes.
And Mr. Webb?
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
I think we can we stay in here? Or?
Yeah.
Shauna, your phone case matches your shirt.
Oh, wow. And Phil continues the tradition of somebody knocking something off the table in the middle of the meeting. It's been me the past several meetings. You